Welcome back to this next video, and in this video we are going to talk about the interferons. The interferons, they are proteins made and released by host cells in response to the presence of various pathogens like the viruses, bacteria, the parasites, or the tumor cells. And in this video, we are going to focus on the function of the interferons when there is a viral infection in the cell. The interferons, they allow for communication between cells to trigger the protective defense of the immune system that eradicate pathogens or the tumors. Now, what happens is that once a cell that is infected by a virus, it is sending the signal in the form of the interferon, and these interferons are actually preparing the uninfected cells for the infection of the viruses. So it means that the interferons, they are very important for communication between cells. We will come to that in a while. Now, the interferons, they belong to a large class of the glycoproteins known as the cytokines. The glycoproteins are those proteins which, when are made, are changed by the process of post-translational modification by the addition of the carbohydrate moieties. So we call them as the glycoprotein. This glyco is actually showing the carbohydrate part of the protein, which has been added to the protein once the protein has been made. Now, these cytokines, they are broad induced category of the small proteins, and the molecular weight is between 50 to 20 kilodaltons. They are very important in cell signaling. So these cytokines, as they are very important in cell signaling, therefore the interferons, when they are put in this particular class, they are there because they are also responsible for signaling between different kind of the cells. Now, they are released by cells and affect the behavior of other cells and sometimes the releasing cell itself. And in this particular video, we'll be focusing on this component, that how these interferons, when they are released by cell, how they affect the behavior of the other cells. Now, why we call them is the interferons. Now, they are called as the interferons because they have the ability to interfere with the replication of the viruses within the host cell. Therefore, they are known as the interferons. If you talk about the important functions of the interferon, they are the first important function of the interferon is that they activate the immune cells, such as the natural killer cells and the macrophages. Another important function is that they increase recognition of infection or tumor cells by upregulating antigen presentation to the T lymphocytes. And another important function is that they increase the ability of uninfected host cells to resist new infection by the virus. So in this particular video, our main focus will be this one, that how the interferon, they increase the ability of the uninfected host cells to resist new infection by the virus. If talk about the symptoms of the production of the interferons, they include itching muscles and fevers. And the number of the interferons that have been so far identified in mammals, that is about 20 interferons they have been identified in mammals, and about 7 of them they have been described for humans. The interferons, they are broadly divided into two classes based on the type of receptor through which they signal. So this particular classification is based on the type of the receptor to which the interferon bind and they signal the particular cell. The first class of the interferon, that is known as the type 1 interferon, and the second class is known as the type 2 interferon. And the interferon belonging to both of these classes, they are very important for fighting the viral infections. Let us discuss about the interferon type 1 or the type 1 interferon. All type 1 interferon, they bind to a specific cell surface receptor, which is known as the interferon alpha beta receptor. This interferon alpha beta receptor is made up of two chains. One chain is known as the interferon alpha receptor 1, and the other one is known as the interferon alpha receptor 2. So this interferon alpha beta receptor is made up of these two genes. When the interferon, they bind to this particular receptor, the interferon alpha beta receptor, they are going to activate a pathway known as the JAK-STAT signaling pathway, and we will be discussing that in detail how this particular pathway is working. The type 1 interferon present in the humans are, if you look at the examples of type 1 interferons that are present in the human, they are the interferon alpha, the interferon beta, the interferon epsilon, the interferon omega. These are just some of the examples of the type 1 interferon that are present in the human beings. Now, these type 1 interferon, they are produced by the leukocytes, the WBCs, the like the neutrophils, the eosinophils, the basophils, the lymphocytes. They are also produced by the monocytes, and they are also produced by the fibroblasts. And fibroblasts, they are very important for the production of the interferon beta. Now, let us discuss the receptor of the this interferon alpha beta receptor in a little bit detail. This interferon alpha beta receptor, it is actually a transmembrane protein. What I mean by that is that if you talk about both of these subunits, both of these genes, the interferon alpha receptor 1 and the interferon alpha receptor 2, both of these genes, they are transmembrane protein. And the important property of a transmembrane protein is they have got an extracellular domain which is present outside the cell. They have got a transmembrane domain which is present inside the cell membrane, and they have got an intracellular domain which is present inside the cells. So each of these genes, the interferon alpha receptor 1 and the interferon alpha receptor 2, both of these genes, they have got these three domains: the ligand binding domain on the N-terminal domain, which is present outside the cell, the transmembrane domain, which is present inside the cell membrane, and the intracellular domain, which is present inside the cell. So you can see that for the interferon alpha receptor 2, they have got these three domains, and you can see that for the interferon alpha receptor 1, again, they have got these three domains over here. If you talk about the interferon alpha receptor 1 first, as you can see is that their N-terminal domain, which is also known as the ligand binding domain, they have got four subdomains, and they are represented by SD1, the subdomain 1, subdomain 2, 3, and 4. So the N-terminal or the ligand binding domain of the interferon alpha receptor 1 is made up of these four subunits. Now, the interferon alpha, that is going to bind to the SD1, SD2, and SD3. So you can say that these three subdomains, the SD1, SD2, and SD3, they are actually providing a binding site for the interferon alpha. The transmembrane domain, the function of the transmembrane domain is to provide stability to this particular chain. And the intracellular domain that is present inside the cell is that it is used, that the message of the interferon which has bind to the ligand binding domain on the outside of the cell, its message can be communicated to the interior of the cell. So you can simply say that the function of the interferon alpha is actually read by this C-terminal or the intracellular domain which is present inside the cell. So the interferon alpha receptor 1 have got these four subunits on their ligand binding domain, and only the three of them, they are responsible for binding to the interferon. The interferon alpha receptor 1 C-terminal domain is bound by a special protein which is known as the TYK2. And this TYK2 is actually a JAK protein. We will discuss that. And this is the first member of the JAK family that was described. So this is also a JAK, only the name is different, although both of them, they belong to the same class. This JAK and the TYK2, both of these proteins, they belong to the same family of the JAK. If you talk about the interferon alpha receptor 2, its ligand binding domain have only got two subdomain known as the D1 and the D2, and the D1 and the D2, they are responsible for binding to the interferon. Again, the transmembrane domain is responsible for stability of this particular chain, and the intracellular domain is bind to the JAK1. So the message which is present outside the cell in the form of the interferon, after it binds to the ligand binding domain, it is transferred to the intracellular domain, and the intracellular domain is then going to start a particular signaling pathway. Initially, what happens that when the interferons, they are not binded to the interferon alpha receptor 1 or the interferon alpha receptor 2, they are away from each other. And when they are away from each other, that means that both of these chains, and hence its associated JAK, they are inactive. But when the interferon binds to them, the binding of the interferon is going to combine the two receptor chains with each other, and when they combine with each other, after their combination, the JAK, the which is attached to both of the chain, they are going to activate each other, thereby starting the JAK-STAT signaling pathway. So this is about the receptor, which is for the interferon alpha, which is the interferon alpha beta receptor. If you talk about the functions of the type 1 interferons, they are mainly involved in the innate immune response. And we call the innate immune response as a non-specific defense mechanism that come into play immediately or within hours of an antigen appearance in the body, like chemicals in the blood. In this particular case, interferon can be one of the chemical that is there, and immune system cells that attack the foreign cells in the body. So the type 1 interferon, they are responsible for the innate immune response against the viral infections. Now the gene for the interferon alpha molecules, they are found on the chromosome number 9, and there are also synthetic medications present. There are also synthetic medications which use the interferon alpha. One of the important one is the pegylated interferon alpha 2, which is used to treat chronic hepatitis B and C infection. And the other one is pegylated interferon alpha 2B, which is used to treat chronic hepatitis C infection. As both of them, they are viral infections, and these interferon alpha, they have important antiviral activity, so they are also synthetically made to treat these chronic hepatitis B and C infections. If you talk about the type 2 interferon, they are going to interact with a special receptor which is known as the interferon gamma receptor. The type 1 the receptor for the type 1 interferon is known as the interferon alpha beta receptor, and the receptor for the interferon type 2 is known as the interferon gamma receptor. Now there is only a single type 2 interferon, which is known as the interferon gamma. So in this particular family, you still have a single member, which is known as the interferon gamma. Now the human interferon gamma receptor, again, it is made up of two chains, what is known as the interferon gamma receptor 1, and the other one is known as the interferon gamma receptor 2. Now in unstimulated cells, by that I mean that when there is no interferon gamma, these subunits, the interferon gamma receptor 1 and the interferon gamma receptor 2, they are not pre-associated with each other, they are away from each other, but rather they associate through their intracellular domain with inactive form of specific Janus kinase family. If you look at this one, like if there is no interferon, the interferon gamma receptor 1 and the interferon gamma receptor 2, they are away from each other, but they are still attached to the inactive form of the Janus kinases. And once there is signal of the interferon, they are going to combine with each other, and then these Janus kinases are going to be activated. Now the interferon gamma is produced by the T lymphocytes and the natural killer cells, and they are also responsible for stimulating the activity of the macrophages. And sometime because of their activation of the macrophages, this interferon gamma, they are also known as the macrophage activating factor. Now let us talk about the pathway, how this pathway of the interferon, it works. Now this one is a very general overview how the interferon, they works. When there is viral infection to a cell, the viral infection to a cell, that is going to activate the interferon genes. And when they activate the interferon gene, of course, this is a very long pathway, but I'm putting it very simple. Then when there is a viral infection in the cell, in response to the viral infection, this virally infected cell is going to release these interferons. These interferons, they are going to bind to a receptor present on the uninfected cell. And keep in mind one thing, that these receptors for the interferon are present on almost every cell present in the human body. So when the interferon that is released by the infected cell, they are going to bind to the receptor present on the uninfected cell. And when they bind to the receptor, there is a particular JAK-STAT signaling pathway, which we'll discuss in a while, that is going to send signal to the nucleus, and the nucleus is going to make antiviral protein. And when this particular cell, which is not yet infected by the virus, but it has prepared itself in the form of the antiviral protein, so when the virus, it infects this particular cell, these antiviral protein are going to degrade the virus, and hence this cell will be protected from the infection of the viruses. So this is very simple. So let us discuss this in a little bit detail, how this mechanism actually works. If you look at this one, as I've told you, when there is no interferon, the this is an example of the alpha interferon. We are talking about the type 1 interferons. So we are talking about the alpha and the beta subunit, and you can call this is the interferon alpha receptor 1 and the interferon alpha receptor 2. So initially they are away from each other when there is no interferon. And when they are away from each other, the Janus kinases, the JAK kinases, which are attached to these subunits, they are in the inactive form. Now, this JAK kinase, as the name indicates, this is a kinase, and the kinase proteins have the potential to phosphorylate its target protein. When they are away from each other, they cannot phosphorylate each other or their substrates. But when there is a signal, like when there is an infected cell, it releases the interferon, and the interferon binds to the receptor. So after binding of the interferon, these two subunits, they are going to combine with each other. So therefore, you are getting the dimerization of the receptor. And when there is dimerization of the receptor, as you can see, these two JAK kinases, one attached to one receptor, the other one attached to the other receptor, they are going to phosphorylate each other. Initially, they are in the unphosphorylated form, in the non-phosphorylated form, but when they come to each other, when there is binding of the interferon to the receptor, this Janus kinase is going to phosphorylate this Janus kinase, this JAK kinase is going to phosphorylate this JAK kinase. Now, when the Janus kinase, they activate, when they phosphorylate each other, this phosphorylation is going to activate these Janus kinases. And when the Janus kinase, they activate, what they are going to do is they are going to phosphorylate the receptor on specific tyrosine residues. This Janus kinase, if you put it specifically, the Janus kinase is a tyrosine kinase. What it means is that when it phosphorylates its substrate, it is going to add a phosphate group on the tyrosine residues on its substrate protein. So when the Janus kinases, they are activated by phosphorylation, when they phosphorylate each other, these Janus kinases are going to phosphorylate the receptor on specific tyrosine kinase residues. And now you can see that the both of the chains of the receptor, they have been phosphorylated. Now, when the when both of these chains of the receptor, they have been phosphorylated, they are actually providing a docking site for the attachment of other proteins. One of the important proteins that attaches to these phosphorylated tyrosines of the receptor, they are known as the STAT protein. And the STAT protein is the signal transducers and activators of transcription. So once there are, when there is phosphorylation of the tyrosine residues of the receptor, the STAT protein is going to use its special domain, which is known as the SH2 domain. It is going to utilize its SH2 domain, it is going to bind to these phosphorylated tyrosine of the receptor, and when they bind over there, the Janus kinase is then going to phosphorylate the state protein. Let me put it again, when the Janus kinases, they are phosphorylated, they are going to phosphorylate the receptors. When the receptor, they are phosphorylated, the state protein through its SH2 domain is going to interact with these phosphorylated tyrosine. When the state 2 through its SH2 domain, but it interacts with these phosphorylated tyrosine, it come in contact with the Janus kinase, and the Janus kinase is going to phosphorylate the state protein. Now, when the state protein that have been phosphorylated, they are going to make a dimer. So now you are actually getting a dimer of the states. Initially, when the states, they are in the non-phosphorylated form, they cannot dimerize with each other, but once they are phosphorylated by the Janus kinase, they are going to dimerize with each other. So what you are going to do, what you are seeing is that when the Janus kinase, they are activated, they are going to activate the state protein by phosphorylation, and when the state protein, they are phosphorylated, they are going to be dimerized. One thing to add over here is that this dimer of the state, it is going to combine with another protein which is known as the P48 proteins, and this whole complex, the dimer of the state plus the P48 proteins, that is going to move from the cytoplasm into the nucleus of the cell, and when it goes into the nucleus of the cell, that is going to transcribe specific genes. And this pathway actually is going to activate near the 100 proteins which are immunomodulatory and which are having the antiviral proteins. So in this particular video, we are going to focus on two of the important proteins that are actually transcribed by the complex of the two states and the P48. Now, when the dimer of the state and P48, when it enters the nucleus, the first thing it do is that it is going to transcribe a particular gene which is known as the 2,5-A synthetase, which is known as the 2,5 oligoadenylate synthetase. Now, when this particular gene is transcribed, it is going to make this 2,5-A synthetase, but this is still in the inactive form, and we need its activity if this particular cell is infected by the virus. So when a retrovirus or when a virus, when it enters into the cell, what it do is that this particular double-stranded RNA, it is going to interact with the 2,5-A synthetase, and when the RNA, it interacts with the 2,5-A synthetase, it is activated in the presence of the ATP. So the 2,5-A synthetase is actually activated by the interaction of the double-stranded RNA and the ATP. And when both the ATP and the double-stranded viral RNA that interact with the 2,5-A synthetase, the 2,5-A synthetase is going to get activated. When it is going to, when the 2,5-A is activated, what it is going to do is that it is going to activate an RNase which is known as the RNase L. And initially the RNase L, that is in the inactive form, but when the 2,5-A it's get activated, it is going to activate the RNase L. And this RNase L is going to degrade the viral RNA. And if once you have degraded the viral RNA, that means that the virus is no more able to infect this particular cell. So this is one of the gene that is transcribed by the complex of the dimer of the state and the P48. Another important protein that is activated, that is known as the protein kinase R, or for short that is known as the PKR. Now this PKR initially is in the inactive form, but it's is also activated in the presence of the double-stranded RNA of the virus and the ATP. So when both of them, the double-stranded RNA of the virus and the ATP, they interact with the PKR, it is going to get activated. This PKR is going to phosphorylate a special transcription factor, which is known as the ALF2, And when the it is phosphorylated, the ALF2 is going to interact with a GDP protein. And when the GDP protein, it interacts with this transcription factor, it is going to be non-functional. And both of these pathways are actually going to inhibit the protein synthesis of the virus. And when there is inhibition of the protein synthesis of the virus, that means that the virus has no ability to infect this new cell. So this is how the interferon, they are actually helping the uninfected cell to stay prevented from the infection of the virus.